Hey, book warrior. We're twinning. Hey, book warriors. It's Sunday night, and Melissa, Diane, we're here to do some baking today, and we're also talking about, we're doing some wine. We're talking about A Murder Yule Regret, which was our book club book choice for this December. So, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. Happy New Year, book warriors.
So, how was your holiday, Diane?
It was good. We, my sisters-in-law came to North Carolina, and we got to ski one day with my niece, which was great because now the ski resort is closed because all the snow melted. They're supposed to get snow this weekend.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, that's horrible up there because financially that can devastate a tourist town. But
schools are going remote here tomorrow because of the storm.
Okay.
They're predicting snow.
Oh, I'm supposed to get on the road tomorrow to Nashville.
You better check.
But they were good. The kids were home from all the way across the country. Our daughter from LA and our son from Vancouver. He had a heck of a time getting home, but at least he had come.
So. And a heck of a time getting back.
A heck of a time getting, well, I was home to him. Never lived in North Carolina, so I don't
know.
Home is where the mom is, right?
Exactly.
Should be.
Exactly.
Yeah, but overall it was good. I always get a little melancholy around, you know, the new year. So we just went to bed at 10 o'clock on New Year's Eve so that I wouldn't get all wham-wham.
Oh, it's too bad.
Yeah.
We stayed up. We went to movies, actually. We saw Nightmare Alley.
Was it good?
It was good. Yeah, it was really, really dark. It's Bradley Cooper and Kate Blanchett and Mara Rooney and can't think of who else. So it's like a carnival setting, and Nightmare Alley is kind of like Skid Row or, you know, like the dark places in town. Mm-hmm. So it's not like a horror, but it was kind of a mystery and kind of a drama and some very surprising twists towards the end that we did not expect at all, none of us.
So we're seeing?
Yeah.
Okay.
I would say, yeah.
Add that to my list. We saw the new Spider-Man. That was good. Except the people behind us were coughing on the pot, so we got moved in the middle of the...
That's annoying.
Yeah, we're kind of like, okay, we're not eating our popcorn or drinking our drink anymore now. We're just going to get up and move.
Oh.
That's
too bad.
Which I'm sure you want to hear that sitting next to me. I will lean way over.
No, one of my sons, he was exposed yesterday. Somebody tested positive, so now he's quarantining. It's sad.
Yeah, I mean, who would have thought we'd still be dealing with this at this point? But we're going to be happy. We're doing fun things tonight and talking about a wonderful, wonderful book.
So. Yes, and I have three signed copies to give away. So I will wait until tomorrow around noon and choose some random people from the comments. So leave a comment and I will mail you a signed copy of A Murder Yule Regret.
Cool. That's a nice perk.
Yeah.
All right. Are you ready for questions or do we want to start doing?
Let's do a few questions and then we're going to do some baking. So in the back of the book, one of the recipes is the star bread and it's one of the recipes that Elia makes. And so we're going to make a star bread tonight.
She has taught me how to make so many cool things. Like that curry recipe and stuff. And she's going to teach me cinnamon rolls at some point too.
So. I have a Masaman curry recipe for
ooh,
you. It's really good and it's easy. It's a one pot.
And so caramel popcorn.
Oh yeah. We made buckets of that stuff.
I actually shared that recipe with Amy this weekend. A friend of my husband's friend's girlfriend. Caramel corn. So we should post that on the book warriors page because that is a good recipe.
Yeah, that's my ninth grade home ec recipe and we still make it every year.
So one of the references I loved in the book, of course, was the reference to Betty White.
I know.
That Mrs. Branford was like a spunky Betty White. And that was, and of course, you know, you had no idea when you wrote the book and when it got published that Betty White was gonna be mentioned. But did you have a favorite role that Betty White was in?
Well, so she was often in my head as I wrote Penelope Branford.
Kind of a role for that.
Because I like to picture actors in the roles, like who would play this character, who would play that character, then I hear them in my head. And, you know, I've gone back and forth on who would play Mrs. Branford, but often it came back to Betty White, but particularly in certain roles. So in The Proposal, Sandra Bullock and Ryan Reynolds, and she plays Gammy. And So Mrs. Bramford, she's just like, she's spunky, right? And she's a little diabolical. She's got a little secret side to her. And, you know, like she goes off in one of the books and goes down to the poker room at a bar and stuff like that. And so in The Proposal, when Gammy pretends to have a heart attack, have you seen that movie?
The Proposal, yeah. I saw it, but it's been a long time ago.
So like they're split up and Sandra Bullock's being taken back for immigration, and Ryan Reynolds is, you know, in despair, and Gammy knows that they love each other, and so she goes into this heart attack, and they're taking her off in the seaplane ambulance thing, and she's like, you know, prying her eye open, and at the end, you know, she's like,
I need to rewatch that movie.
Just pretending because you two love each other, you're just too stupid to know it. So that was something that Mrs. Bramford would do. So that type of Betty White was definitely in my head. But I remember watching her with Mary Tyler Moore.
When we were young,
Did you watch The Golden Girls?
I did watch The Golden Girls some. Yeah, I've watched probably more in reruns. Yeah, I loved her in that. And I loved Hot in Cleveland more recently. She was so good at that because she was kind of a little more sassy. And I like that she kind of put the women in their place sometimes. She was a good addition to that.
I'm just not typically a, as you know, like a sitcom kind of person. But
I love sitcoms. The stupider, the better.
And I was in college and then having babies with the Golden Girls. So I never really watched it, but it's a good friend of mine in Texas, Katie Rose. Hey, Katie. It's her favorite show of all time. And so I keep thinking, oh, I should watch that sometime.
I've watched some episodes recently, and, you know, and some of them have aged well better than others, you know, because, you know, of course it was made when like 30 years ago.
Yeah.
So some of the references, but you know, it's kind of interesting just to see how times have changed and stuff. So, I mean, any shows from
Yeah.
Even, gosh, even 5 years ago, some of it's kind of
dated. Yeah. Okay. So, hey, Tracy. XOXO. So glad you're here, Cheryl. Happy New Year. Happy New Year, Mary. Good to see you. Happy New Year, Heather and Carol. Hi. And I know, love that movie too, Heather. Rest in peace.
What movie was it?
The Proposal. Oh, rest in peace, Betty. Hi, Joanne and Amanda. And did I say Carol already? I think. Enough. Yeah. Yeah, so thanks for being here with us on January 2nd of 2022.
Thanks. And so, as I mentioned, we're at Melissa's house. And so, speaking of houses, I felt like there was like a house theme kind of subtly in this book. I don't know if you did that on purpose, if that was more subtle, but the glass house that Eliza lived in, I thought, is that metaphorical?
Yeah, because, you know, don't throw stones.
Yeah.
And then she's like in a fishbowl, right, as a starlet and the it girl and all of that. And yet she's got this past that she is trying to escape, you know, and yet she ended up in this career where she's, you know, front and center for everybody. So yeah, it was a little metaphorical. Plus it was just fun to describe.
I mean, when I read it, I'm like, I'm going to see this place. I thought that would be really cool to live in, to kind of be
on a cliff.
You could have like, almost feel like you're outside, kind of like a sun, like your whole house is a sunroom, and then just close the curtains when you want to do it. But I'm sure it would not be very efficient to heat or cool, but I guess in California, you know, that's not as much of a concern. So.
Right.
And I also, speaking of houses, so not to spoil the end, if anybody didn't read to the end, plug your ears, but when the first thing I thought when Miguel proposed was, which house are they going to live in, the Tudor or the bungalow? And I'm like, they both sound so cute. I don't know which one they should live in. And then immediately after that, Ivy thought that. I thought, oh God, all women think alike.
Right? and I still don't have the answer to that, because the next book, Bread Over Troubled Water, which comes out at the end of next year, it's about the engagement party, but it doesn't tackle that important question of where they're going to live. So I don't have the answer to that yet.
Maybe she can hang out, rent hers out or something, or rent his out.
Well, I was actually thinking of hers could be a photography studio.
That's cool.
So she could use it in that way.
Yeah. I also liked how at one point you talked about how houses really tell you a lot about the people who live in them and how they look. And you describe Miss Branford's house and Ivy's house. And I was thinking, gosh, what does my messy house say about me? We always keep the outside of our house looking nice. And it does say, you know, I respect the neighbors. I want to put on a nice appearance. But the inside of my house just looks like a tornado.
Oh, that is not true. That's not true.
I call it a creative mess. You know, I kind of feel like if people are coming over, I will clean up. But it's like, you know, I've got stuff to do that's more important. That's how I feel.
Well, I move piles from one place to another. Oh, so. that's often
the perfection. whole thing, isn't it? It's hard to get the entire house cleaned up.
Yeah, but we were talking with our kids actually, because they were all home too for the holidays, and Carlos is always one to pose questions at dinner, you know, thought-provoking questions, and so he's like, "What?" No, actually, I think it came from a conversation card, because we have a box of conversation cards, which is kind of fun.
That's cool, yeah.
But it was, the question was, what traits did you get from your mom and from your dad?
Ooh.
And so we went around the table, and my oldest son, AJ, so one of the things that he said is he gets his, like, decorating and desire to create a, you know, nice living space from him. And I get that from my mom for sure. So yeah, it was kind of nice, but I do, I love the decorating, and so I tend to pull that stuff into my books too.
If anyone's wondering why I keep doing this, Kippen is down there. I don't know if y'all met.
No.
Melissa's dog, Kippen. She was chewing on my stool leg a minute ago, but
can I hold her up?
Yeah. I'm going to pour some water.
I got to babysit her a couple weeks ago.
Oh my gosh, you were a lifesaver.
And my dog loved her.
She's about doubled in size, right?
Yes, she's doubled in size.
And we want her to stop growing. There's
growing, Kippen. No, you're not allowed to grow anymore.
Aw.
You're getting too big, just like my kittens. They grew too fast. Meh.
They still act like kittens.
I know.
Insane.
Hi, Emily and Susan. And Juvan says, I love your kitchen. Thank you. I love my kitchen, too.
She's got an awesome. I have kitchen envy every time I come over here. My whole kitchen could fit in, like, this little corner.
Yeah, we got lucky. Well, this house did not look like this when we bought it. And we did a lot of renovation. We took down some walls and we opened it up. Should I like do a scan?
Yeah. Like there used to be a whole wall here and it's gone.
Yeah. So yeah, we moved the refrigerator there. That's our brand new refrigerator though. It's pretty cool. And then new everything here. The window was there. And then there was a wall right there and there was a wall right there, which we took down. Just to make it what we wanted it to be. And I love it. It's my favorite kitchen of all time.
Did you get to do any of the demo? Did you get to like hit the wall with the...
We did a little bit, yeah.
I think that'd be fun. I've seen these. Where did I see this? It was called like break rooms where you can go and break stuff.
Oh,
was it a TV show? Where did I see that?
That would be pretty therapeutic, I would think.
I can't remember now. Was it Insecure? Somebody tell me. Maybe.
I don't know. I've not seen Insecure, so I don't know.
And that ended too. That made me sad. That ended, which made me sad. And then I watched Being the Ricardos the same day. And it was like, they were both, you know, I mean, like the Insecure, I loved it. It ended well. It was a very well done series. I was just sad that it was over. And then Being the Ricardos was just kind of.
Sophie and I just watched Being the Ricardos too and really enjoyed it. And I did not realize what a sort of strong woman and how opposite in character Lucille Ball is from Lucy she played in Lucy, you know. Yeah. I knew she was a business woman and I think she's credited with creating the multiple cameras for sitcoms.
Oh, that's cool.
I'm pretty sure she is. But yeah, she was so strong in that movie and just like so determined and like she had such a vision on, you know, the way she redid that dinner scene so many times.
Yeah.
Very, very I can't even think of the word. You know, she just needed things to be a certain way. And she she like really had a vision and she stuck to her guns and pretty amazing. It was really great.
Well, she knew what was funny, you know. I mean her shows are so timeless too, because the stuff that they made fun of, you know, marriages and neighbors and friendships and all that, it's still so relevant today, you know. That's why it's so evergreen. And my daughter even loved I Love Lucy when she was a teenager. She'd get up to go to high school and it was always on in the morning while she was eating her Pop-Tarts or whatever, and she'd watch it. And I remember thinking that I liked that she could enjoy it too, because it was even, you know, old when we were young, but that she could enjoy it too. And it just never even though the clothes and stuff are dated, the theme.
I'm kind of surprised Betty White didn't have a cameo in that or a role, because I was looking at IMDb today at Betty White's roles and she's had like 122
or
123 roles over the years. She was born in 1922, I think it said. And I mean, she was in Petticoat Junction. Do you remember that?
Oh my gosh, yeah.
She's been in like NCIS. She's been in, I don't know, you name it. She's been in it. So I'm surprised she wasn't actually.
Yeah,
in
that's true. Yeah.
She's in so many things. Yeah.
So Pippa was chewing it. Do we want to start on the bread or another question?
Okay, yeah. So, let's start on the bread. So one of the things that I like to do, wash my hands real quick.
Yeah, I guess I should get the dog germs off my hands, right? Yeah. Even though it probably wouldn't bother us.
Yeah, we're going to be the ones eating it. So I get to put recipes in all the back of my books, which I love to do. And all my books have food featured in them in some way, shape, or form. Maybe except for my romantic suspense mysteries. I don't think they have food. But it's a lot of fun. And so I get to bake and then we get to eat. In fact, Carlos was in here earlier going, where's that bread? I want that bread.
It'll be ready very soon.
Yeah. So we're going to make star bread. We talked about doing the Yule log, but I don't know, since Christmas is over and it just, I don't know, hot flashes, chocolate. It just didn't, I was not feeling it today.
That's so many steps too.
Yeah.
I mean, it did sound like I read through all the recipes and I thought, oh, that sounds really cool. I'm going to try that one time. Mm-hmm. But it sounded like I was actually surprised to learn by reading the recipe that you roll it up before you fill it, that you roll it up and then unroll it. Because I would have thought the more you manipulated it, that would be more chance to break or whatever. But
no, because you, if you watch the Great British Baking Show, you know, that if you watch the New Year's Baking Show with the Dairy Girls on the Great British Baking Show, which is
I haven't been able to find it.
Oh my gosh, it is the best. But she has to, one of them has to redo it several times because you have to roll it when it's warm into like parchment paper and then let it cool. And then you can unroll it and manipulate it. But if you roll it, if you let it cool first, then it's going to break.
Oh, okay. Because it's like hardened.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, so the recipe in the back of the book is not gluten-free, but this is gluten-free. And
do you want me to angle this down just slightly so they can see the workspace?
Found the greatest gluten-free blog ever. It's called Let Them Eat Gluten-Free Cake, which I love. Love that. And she's pretty amazing. And we always make cinnamon rolls on Christmas morning. And so this year I tried her cinnamon roll recipe and it was absolutely the best ever. And so then when I was looking for a gluten-free star bread recipe, this is the first one that came up. So I was like, okay, we're gonna make that.
This is cool with all the little
This is like a pie crust. It has measurements. So okay, so you have your gluten-free, in my case, dough, or your regular dough, and you divide it into four equal.
Should I be doing one?
Sure. Four equal sizes. We're going to roll them one at a time. And I measured, so we're going to roll them to about 12 inches. And this is not the exciting part. The exciting part comes after this part, but bear with us. It's pretty great dough. You know, gluten-free dough can often be pretty sticky and hard to work with, and this is not.
Yeah, this just feels like regular dough.
Yeah, it has a whole lot of butter in it. Okay, so not a perfect circle, close enough. So I'm going to take it and put it on my little tray.
Which I do mine.
Like this, yeah. Okay, now we have a brand new jar of raspberry, seedless raspberry jelly that we just get to spread onto this thing. There are some recipes that use like an almond paste or I guess other, you could probably do any filling. You could probably do any filling, but we're doing this because you'll see when it rolls out, like when we do the twisting, it's really festive and cool. So that's why they call it the star bread.
I have some kind of fig stuff that I bought. Oops, I needed to put more. Some fig kind of jelly that I got at Weaver Street that I need to do something with. So I should put it in something like this.
Oh, well.
What am I doing?
You need.
I need more flour so it doesn't stick.
You need to eat brie because fig jelly and brie is great. But then you don't eat too much cheese, right? Yeah, you need like a vegan cheese.
Oh, I guess I need more flour.
Yeah.
I'm not a natural cook. I like cake decorating and that kind of stuff. I'm good at that once it's made.
You make Christmas cookies too?
We didn't do it this year, but we normally do. We make the gingerbread houses and stuff. I love doing that.
Oh, we did too. Yeah.
Roundish?
Yeah.
So it's oblong.
We do. Our new tradition is a gingerbread like contest.
Oh, cool. Fun.
All right. So now you're going to spread the jelly and I'll roll it.
Okay. So we're just making layers.
Yep. And it's going to be super messy in a few minutes. But it looks really, really cool. So, okay, so if you're watching here, what's your favorite Christmas holiday treat that you bake? Because for us, it's cinnamon rolls, for sure, Christmas morning. We do an egg bake that I found in a magazine years and years ago, and it was Brad Pitt's mother's recipe, and it's supposedly his favorite, you know, like one of her the favorite things of hers back then.
Cooking for Brad.
Yeah. So I clipped it, and now, of course, we modify it, and of course, my daughter, Sophia, who's all health food.
I like rum balls.
She makes it super, super healthy.
She does like a different version of it. How does she modify it to make it more healthy?
She puts in vegetables.
Oh, okay.
Rather than just cheese and sausage.
Okay. Can't talk and do this at the same time. It's too taxing on my brain.
Okay, last one. You want to roll it?
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I've never made rum balls, but I've had like that other people have made, and I always liked those too.
I don't know if I've ever had a rum ball. I know. Oh, I guess I should see. So Heather says, do you try and make all the recipes before putting them in the book? Do you taste test all or just go on the taste test? So great question. Usually I do, except as I said, gluten-free and my son, we have two kids with celiac and my daughter and I have never been tested, but we don't eat. you want to say hi?
No.
So it's hard sometimes to do the non-gluten free. So I don't always do them, but I try and find somebody that will, if I don't do them. But this time I have the cocktail that I put in there. I put in the peppermint cocktail and I thought we can't go wrong with the drink. It looks great. Right. And so I did not test that. And that's the one that we did with Amy.
Oh yeah.
It was horrible. It tasted like NyQuil. Because of the cream de menthe. So that was a super fail. And I definitely need to.
Well, there's probably somebody's out there that would like it. But yeah, it was
somebody
not.
Who likes NyQuil for their cocktails. I don't know.
I remember we were somewhere one night and my husband got rumple mints. And it's a super pepperminty liqueur. And he got it like in a, just a glass and it was like a couple shots or something. And it was kind of like that, where it was just like.
So like Jaeger, what is it, Jägermeister?
Jägermeister is licorice.
Which I've is equally bad.
I mean, I've had a bad experience with Jägermeister. I don't like Jägermeister anymore. It was on a New Year's Eve.
All right.
Yeah, gave me a super bad headache the next morning.
So this one we don't put jelly on.
Okay.
This is our final.
So the top one, does it need to be bigger?
Yeah.
Okay,
I didn't get it quicker. Just a little bit more. Okay, so I need to be
rougher with it.
Yeah. Well, you go. You go, girl. Okay, Tracy. IKR. I'm jelly. What's IKR?
IKR.
I don't know. I'll text you lingo. Yeah. Sorry, Tracy. You're gonna have to spell it out for us.
We're not as cool as you, Tracy.
I know.
Sorry.
We
try to be, but
okay, let's see. Betty White was about 2 weeks older than my dad, Mary says. He would have been turning 100 years old next month.
Oh,
he's still alive. Oh, I'm sorry, Mary.
Yeah.
Carol, Nashville has Bashville, a rage room. Oh, rage room where you can go and break things. I haven't been yet. Oh, that's what you're talking about. Well, you're going to Nashville.
Yeah, we may have to go do that, Carol. I'm going to see Carol this week.
Oh, is that the Carol? Carol?
Is it Carol Pickett?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, Carol.
Yep.
You're taking Diane from me. What?
We're going to have fun.
Okay, let's see. Heather
she says, reminded me to pack my bathing suit for the hot tub.
Oh, that sounds
otherwise, sad. I guess I would have had to do it in my birthday suit. No.
Okay.
Carol's like, no.
Heather says, I made cornbread casserole this year for the first time. My husband requested it. Every year
good.
I make pizzellis? Is that how you say it? Pizzellis? With Hershey bar rolled in the middle. So good with a cup of tea. I think I need that recipe.
I've heard of those, but yeah, I've never made those. Is that
is perfectly round.
It looks kind of like a buffalo high.
Okay, Tracy says, my wife always made cinnamon rolls, eggs, bacon, on Thanksgiving and Christmas mornings. Our daughter continues that tradition. Yeah, we do the egg, bacon, cinnamon rolls, and my kids love the tradition.
So in other words, Tracy gets away with doing nothing. Is that what you're saying? We want to know how to do that.
Okay, Susan, kolache. Is that kolache like in Texas, or is that kolache like the German cookies?
Oh.
Because they're like thumbprint cookies with
Yeah, we both lived in Texas, and there was a big are Kalachis German, or are they Czech?
I think it was Czech.
Okay, yeah. There's Czech communities there, and they would have kolache places. And those were good. I liked how soft the dough was when they cooked.
I never had any, but it was different. My mom would make kolachki cookies, which are just like kind of like little butter cookies, and you put your thumb in and you put either like a cream cheese mixture or jelly.
So that's similar. So kind of sounds like almost like a spinoff of it or something.
Oh, send me the recipe. Thank you, Heather. All right. And Carol says to Tracy, oh, I have a tree in my yard. Knocked down from a tornado. I think I'm going to charge people to come and bash it into people. Oh, that's a great idea,
yeah.
Carol.
Yeah, their yard got, luckily.
Was that a recent
one? I think she said two trees came down, but luckily nothing, you know, hit the house or anything, but they were out of electricity for a while. Yeah, because she was saying she had a generator and the neighbors were coming over to use their generator to charge their phone. So,
okay.
Yeah.
So it doesn't even matter that it doesn't look pretty right now, because what we're going to do is we're going to put a little circle-y thing in the center. Okay, and we're going to divide this. Let's take out the little dog hair.
Oh, the dog hair adds protein and flavor.
We'll eat it. No worries. Okay. We're going to divide it into 16 pieces, just like you were cutting a pie.
Okay.
So this is, just bear with me while I do this, and then we get to the fun, messy part. Can you guys see what I'm doing? I don't know. Kinda.
Yeah, there's kind of.
Let's see. What is that? Oh, wine bottles are in the way. There we go. That's better. Okay, so 16. You want to cut some of them?
Yeah.
Carol, oh, nut rolls. Susan says those are nut, what, but I forgot what the question was. Oh, kolache. Oh, they're nut rolls? So that's different.
That sounds good too, though. I love nuts.
Yeah. Diane, we can go to Bashville if you like, and you can choose among the axes, chainsaws. Oh, we went axe throwing recently.
Ooh, oh, did you? Oh, fun.
Yeah, we went to New Bern for a little getaway like 2 months ago, and we went axe throwing.
Lindsay's done that too, and she said it was really fun.
It was really fun.
This is cool. It kind of looks like a starburst, yeah, or like a flower with petals.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think stuff that kind of like lets you burn off your aggression is good.
Yeah, and once you got the hang of it, like it was hard at first actually getting it to stick on the wall.
Yeah.
But once you figured out the technique and chose the right axe for you, then it was pretty cool. All right, so we have this divided into 16 pieces. And now what we do is we take two at a time and we roll them away from each other, so kind of twist them.
Okay, kind of spiraling it.
Yep. And then we do this one away from it, and then we're going to pinch them together so when they rise, see, like that.
Cool.
So you can go that way and I'll go this way. So then it's going to rise again for 30 minutes. And then it kind of puffs up, and you see all this jelly kind of come through, and it's really festive. So, yeah, so I might add this to our Christmas morning repertoire, along with our cinnamon rolls.
Well, this seems like something, yeah, it could be a breakfast, a dessert.
I'm not a great breakfast eater. I like carbs. And so I think that I'm going to freeze these cut them and then take one out every day.
Yeah, that's great.
For my morning coffee or tea. There we go. All right, so should we ask another question while we're rolling?
Oh, okay. Yeah.
All dirty?
So here, I'll just use my knuckle. Okay.
Can you unlock your phone with your knuckle?
I can. I have talented knuckles.
Wow.
Okay, so what are the you know, of course, being a wordsmith, you know, I love when I see very clever use of language. And one of the metaphors that I loved in your book was you said that Eliza's father, he was rising up from the shrub like a defectively slow Jack in the Box. And I thought, I can totally picture that, you know, him popping up and then kind of like looking in the window. And it made me laugh out loud. I thought, that was such a good description. So were you aware when you phrased that, where you're like, wow, that was some inspired writing?
No, I wasn't, actually. So I'm glad
I love that.
But I find that I don't go back and read my books very often, only once in a while. I've read my romantic suspenses, Silent Obsession, and Silent Echoes. And you know, I read mostly in bed at night. And I just remember as I was reading those going, oh my gosh, what happens next? Oh my God. Wow.
We forget.
So, yeah. I was like, oh my gosh, that's really good. I love that. I was like brilliant in that moment. So when I'm writing and no, I don't necessarily have that feeling, but after when I've reread it, you know, 2 years later, I have, I'll be like, wow, that was good.
Another thing, this is appropriate given what we're doing right here, was your reference to the Rosca de Reyes, like the king.
Oh, yeah, the kings.
Yeah. So, you know, I had king cakes that were inspired by, I guess, New Orleans, the mm-hmm. Catholic tradition. And the first time I heard about them was from my friend Gina, who's from Mexico City. And she was talking about them and how there'd be the little plastic baby Jesus in there.
Yeah.
Kings had that in there, she said, would then throw a party on a later date, and I forgot exactly, like on Epiphany. Or,
Epiphany, which yeah. is January 6th, which is the day that the three wise men, came to see Jesus.
Yes, that was just a cool thing. So I was just wondering, how did you learn about the cakes? And of course, we just talked a little bit about what they mean. So is it just a Catholic thing, or is it a Latino thing?
That's a good question. Probably more of an Hispanic thing. So I just did an egg wash, in case you were wondering. Probably more of an Hispanic thing, and I probably was just looking up cultural breads.
Yeah. That's one of the things I love about your books is how it spans all these cultures. So, okay.
Yeah, so it was really fun. In the next book, there's a whole Hungarian
Ooh.
Bread, which was cool. But yeah, so Rosca is wreath. So it's okay. I think it's wreath, but I think typically the bread is like an oval because of how they cut it or something, but I think actually it's a wreath and it is for Epiphany, but like the king's cake they do at Mardi Gras because it's the beginning of Lent.
Oh, okay.
So in Northern,
those don't have a baby in them then, do they?
I think they do.
I was thinking they did or maybe I'm just getting the two. I might be crossing the two in my head.
I don't know.
If y'all know, clarify for us.
Okay. So in the magic of TV and Facebook Live, here's our thing that has to rise for 30 minutes, but we didn't want to wait and then bake. That's what it looks like. So you can see all the jelly that kind of makes it all pretty.
The finished product. Yeah.
Yeah.
That is beautiful.
So now we can have a piece.
I love all the textures and everything.
Yeah. So there you have it. Star bread. Gluten-free, this particular recipe, the regular recipe is on my website, and I'll post the link to the gluten-free, Let Them Eat Gluten-Free cake.
It's beautiful.
Let me get it right.
Okay, so I'll admit that I was super relieved that Eliza had not been abused in any way. I just kicked her. So I kicked her again, trying to move my leg. I'm just going to keep my legs back.
Okay, I'll give you a call.
But she certainly had a heartbreaking childhood. And so I'm just wondering how you came up with her as a character. And she was somebody I really had a lot of sympathy for. And even her father, once I realized that he was just trying to reconcile with her and make up for you know, bad parenting. And of course, he was a young father, too. So,
yeah, so with circumstances that, you know, you don't necessarily have control over.
Yeah.
So, it was hard. Actually, it was when I first turned in the manuscript, it was a little vaguer. And my editor was like, okay, we need to think about that a little bit more and be a little bit more specific about what her trauma was. Because I had that in mind, but I didn't want to be explicit with that. And so then I kind of rethought, you know, what it actually was and revamped it a little bit.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad she escaped before anything got bad, but yeah, that gave her a really good reason for wanting to reinvent herself, like My Fair Lady and take on a new name and all that. So I also thought it was interesting that you had two murders instead of just one.
Well, you know what they say in writing groups, if you get stuck in the middle, make them have sex or kill somebody. Since this is a cozy mystery, I went with murder.
Either way, they're physical contact, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
This is good.
Yeah.
Just the right amount of sweetness.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is plum jelly that from my canned jelly.
Oh, okay.
And then Carlos bought raspberry jelly, which is what the recipe calls for.
Yeah, this is good.
Yeah.
So it made the murders more complex because we had to figure out, okay, now who on our suspect list would have reason to kill both of these people? Because it'd be too coincidental for it to be unrelated. But,
and that's exactly the process that Ivy went through, and who could have been at both places, and yeah, kind of winnowing it down.
Did that make plotting harder or easier? I'm curious.
Well, we've talked about this before, how you're much more of a plotter and I'm much more not. I'm trying to be. But so I have some broad plot points, and then a lot of the story unfolds. So this murder happened, and I didn't necessarily want it to be her that was murdered, you know, but it was. And so then I had to figure out why and kind of have things evolve, because it hadn't been in the original plot plan to have the second
murder. Oh, wow.
So it was something that evolved as I was writing. And then I went from there. And so then at that point, there was some backtracking in the writing process to make sure, had to go back and forth a little bit to make sure that it all worked. Okay, Carol says, King's cakes have the baby in them. A friend of mine broke a tooth on one. Oh, my gosh.
Ow.
King cake at Mardi Gras, right, because Mardi Gras is the beginning. It's the celebration before Lent. Okay. So it's like it's before Ash Wednesday. So it's okay. Mardi Gras Tuesday. I don't know what they call it, but Mardi Gras Tuesday and then Ash Wednesday.
Okay, so it's kind of the same tradition, but just done at a slightly different time. Interesting. Yeah. And it's so interesting how bread or, you know, cakes and this kind of thing are – yeah, kind of transcend cultures. Every culture has, you know, bread is such a staple, mm-hmm. you know, and cake.
Yeah, because when I first started this series, I really wanted it to be Mexican bread. Well, I wanted this sort of sanguine character to be Latina. And I didn't think that Mexico had a very robust traditional bread tradition, but they actually really do. Which I found really interesting and have had fun researching. Every culture has some variety of it.
Yeah. I like the stuff, the panaderias or whatever, those puffy things that you get for breakfast, those big puffy rolls that are sometimes pink. And purple.
Oh, the conchas.
Is that what they're called? Oh, because they're like conchas?
Yeah.
Conchas?
I have the recipe for the conchas in the first book.
Ooh.
Oh, okay.
I haven't read that. Yeah, because you forgot for me it was in there.
You make the dough, and then you make the sugar topping separate, and it gets laid on top and then baked.
Of course, I can't even remember what I did this morning, so.
Yeah.
Very sad. My brain does not work here.
Oh, my gosh. We watched this movie last night. I don't remember what it's called. Leonardo DiCaprio, Jennifer Lawrence, Ariana Grande is in it.
Mm-hmm. Don't look up.
Meryl Streep. Okay. Mm-hmm. Don't look up. Yes. It took me the longest time to remember Jennifer Lawrence's last name. And I'm like, okay, I seriously.
That was a good movie. I've heard people have very disparate reactions to it. They either think, oh my God, this is just like so predictable.
I loved it.
And then other people were like, cool. I thought it was good too. Yeah.
I thought it was unique.
Yeah. Yeah. And just everybody's reactions and it even had some humor. It was kind of like you could enjoy it on different levels. You know, you could kind of just kind of go, okay, this is kind of just a funny spoof. Or you could kind of go, this is really how the world is. And maybe a giant meteor would be a good thing.
Right. Comment.
Yeah.
Okay. Carol says, does Fat Tuesday come after Margarita Monday? I don't know about Margarita Monday, but Fat Tuesday, I couldn't think of what it was called. I don't know. But yeah, Fat Tuesday is like the last day before Lent, because that's when then you give up whatever you're giving up. So, anyway. Yeah, this is pretty tasty. Can you imagine?
You won't want to give up this. Okay, so another question I had is actually about the cooking process. So you mentioned a less processed organic wheat.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something you've cooked with before? Or?
No, because we've been gluten-free my first son was diagnosed with celiac when he was in fourth grade, and he's 24 now. So it's been like 16 or 17 years. So no, like all the grinding of the wheat and all of that stuff that Eli has in her kitchen, and that's all just stuff that I've researched.
Okay.
And I haven't cooked with, you know, like the real organic.
But it's something that's out there that people could try.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And then there are some bakeries that, you know, that's their sort of claim to pride, you know, that they do this all natural you know, none of the processed stripped down white flours that we get in the store.
Yeah, because I do find, like, with a lot of breads, I like stuff that seems to have more chunks of whatever in it.
Texture.
You know, so I was, texture. So I was kind of wondering about this, if it was, something I should try. Something I need to start cooking more. I need to get into it.
And I mean, if you don't really enjoy it, then
I think my problem
is I should be cleaning more, but I don't really enjoy it.
My problem is I always wait too long to start, so then I'm hangry by the time I'm eating. So I need to do it more, just do it and have something like this where it's around whenever I decide I want, or like you're saying, freeze something. So, because you know what I had recently? My brother-in-law has gotten into roasting his own coffee beans.
Oh, Carlos is doing that too.
Oh, is he really?
Yeah.
Because, oh my God, I had the best cup of coffee I've ever had in my life at Thanksgiving at their house. He had ordered beans from like Ethiopia and Kenya and somewhere in South America and somewhere else. And he had kind of made this like proprietary mix of four different types of beans, but it was just the best.
His proprietary.
Yeah.
That's wild.
Patent pending trademark. But oh my God, it was so good.
Yeah. So we have a neighbor that roasts his own beans. And so he's brought us some. And so then we got Carlos a roaster, which is like Glenn's is way up here and Carlos is his way down here in terms of quality of roaster. But he's been learning the process. But the last couple of batches have been pretty good, and we can get the green beans really cheaply with Cup of Joe's. Or Joe Van Gogh.
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
His main office is over there by the sport.
Oh, wow.
So if Curtis ever wants to get into
that. Wow. Yeah, we don't even have room for our blender in our
He does it in the garage.
Oh, does he? Okay. Charlie had his setup, like, well, he had the stuff in his pantry, but I guess maybe he doesn't do it in there. Maybe he takes it, because he probably has to take it out to do it, too.
It's very quick.
Can I have another little piece of this?
Yeah. This the is so process quick. Is, it's like a, you know, 15 or 20 minute process to roast the beans. It doesn't actually take
long. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
So anyway, that's cool. Yeah. So yeah, no, I haven't actually cooked with stripped down wheat.
Yeah, this is really pretty. This can be like a Thanksgiving thing too. Thanksgiving work. I could see that. Yeah, Easter anytime, really.
Yeah. I mean, I'm telling you, I'm going to make it and stick it in the freezer so I have morning treats. And Carlos loves treats like this too with his coffee in the morning. So
one thing I always love with bread is almonds and chocolate, like the croissants. You could probably do that with this.
So too. This recipe actually did call for an almond paste.
Oh, wow.
And then you put the jelly on top of that. And I omitted that because I am not a nut fan. Except for my husband.
When we get pad thai, she asks him for no peanuts. And I'm like, give me extra peanuts.
No.
I'll take the peanuts she's not using.
Peanuts make me gag. I was so hungry when we took the ski lesson. We don't ski. And when we lived in Colorado, we took a ski lesson at Telluride. So as far as places to take ski lessons, it was pretty cool. But I was starving. And all they had was some peanuts. And so the guy gave me some peanuts. And I tried to eat a few. And I was like, gagging. Man, I hate them. I like creamy peanut butter. But it's a texture thing. Absolutely. Weirdly.
It used to be that way with water chestnuts, but I got over it.
We put water chestnuts in our Thanksgiving stuffing, cornbread stuffing.
So I love that bread. Is it McCormick or Knorr, the vegetable? He's a vegetable soup mix, and you make like a spinach, and you put it in a bread bowl. It's like a dip, and it's, oh my God, it's so good. But it has water chestnuts in it.
Oh,
I make it. I have some of the.
Is it like a spinach?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, I do know what you're talking about.
I can eat that stuff just like. I mean, it's so high calorie, but it's so delicious.
Oh, yeah.
It's so premium.
Well, that's the case with everything, right?
Yeah. Okay, so your next book is coming out. Do you have a date yet?
For this series, no. It was supposed to come out in the summer, and they pushed it back to December from what my editor tells me. And she said it's because their cozy mysteries are doing really great, and they're trying – that's my dishwasher.
Oh, okay.
They're trying to reduce the number of books that they release every month so they don't sort of cannibalize on their own sales.
Oh, yeah.
And so mine was one of the ones that got pushed back. So it's a whole year away. So I don't actually have the date. It's finished. It's been finished. It's called Bread Over Troubled Water. And, yeah, it'll be fun. And that's actually the last one I'm contracted for. So I don't know if there will be any more from the publisher after this one.
Well, it's been a good run. I mean, that's a lot of books. And
yeah, number eight.
A lot of good recipes. This was great. Yeah, I'm going to have to try this.
So Heather's – oh, so Mary says, Margarita Monday is every Monday of the year. That's
that's a good philosophy.
Yeah.
I like your calendar, Mary.
In Arkansas, where my son went to school in Fayetteville, there is a queso restaurant, just queso. margaritas. And so they would go every Monday for the margaritas and queso. And I was like, oh, I want one of those.
Lindsay likes the margaritas with the jalapeno in them.
Oh, I haven't had those.
It's pretty good.
Heather says, would an icing like the kind in the cinnamon rolls make this bread too sweet? Oh, so this is the cinnamon roll dough that she uses. And I don't think so. I mean, the cinnamon, the mixture that she has in her recipe, it wasn't too sweet at all. I mean, it was really great. And then the icing, which we put on the cinnamon rolls, worked. So I think a light icing could be fine with even the jelly.
Yeah, because this is not that sweet. This is just a hint of sweetness.
Yeah, there's plenty of bread, I think, to offset it. So yeah, I think
nice. There's tons of varieties of this you could do.
Oh yeah. In fact, on her recipe, she's like, you could do it with savory stuff, pesto. Pest. I don't know. There was a bunch. She listed a bunch, and I just kind of skimmed over. But yeah, so there were other sweet varieties that she recommended or suggested, and then savory ones too.
Yeah, I used to have a Pampered Chef recipe. I had a friend that sold Pampered Chef, and you know, I always went to her parties, and you would use, you know, they always have like kind of the cheating recipes to make them like really, really quick family friendly mm-hmm. stuff. And they had where you would use crescent dough and kind of make it a
really, oh yeah,
yeah, and it would be like broccoli and cheese. And so it'd be like a broccoli cheese wreath kind of thing. But I had made it with mushrooms one time.
Oh, yeah. I feel like liberated because, yeah, everything uses this crescent dough and we can't do that. And so now that I've discovered this, I'm so excited because you can do it for anything. And it's a super easy dough to make. So
that's always a bonus. Yeah. When something's easy. So this is very versatile.
Oh, so Drew Ann, sorry, yes, I answered the question. It was a egg wash. I love water chestnuts. Ate some for dinner with some dipping sauce. Just water chestnuts, Mary? Water chestnuts and dipping sauce.
Yeah.
Okay. What kind of dipping sauce?
Are they
sauce?
Raw
so
or
curious.
Are they
like from the can?
Yeah. Do you heat them up or anything? I love learning about new.
I know. That's so interesting. Yes, it is a long time between books, Joanne. I'm really actually so disappointed, and you know, I just have no control over it. So.
Publishers seem to be shifting a lot of stuff around, though. I've known other people that have gotten books pushed back because I think part of it they're having trouble getting paper to print. That's one thing I've heard.
That's what my agent was saying, that there's a lot of supply, and so it could be that there are other factors, and this is just the one thing that they're telling people whose books got pushed back.
Yeah.
I could live on queso margaritas, Carol. Me too. Thank you, Heather. She sent me the recipe. Oh, can you tell me how to say it? Pizzellis or Pizzelles? P-I-Z-Z-E-L-L-E-S.
Pizzelles. Yeah, I would think Pizzelles, but maybe I'm...
Pizzelles.
But if it's Italian... I had something called a duck cell at Amelie's. Of course, that's French, I guess. The Amelie's Bakery in Charlotte. Yeah, and it was like an open-faced sandwich. I think it was called a duck cell. D-U-X-E-L-L-E.
Oh, I remember. Yeah.
Yeah.
That when we went together,
mm-hmm.
yeah, okay, with Drianne, we went with
Drianne. Yeah.
Okay, we need
everybody else come visit us.
I know, yeah, Brian, we'll meet you. Tracy's coming, right?
Yeah, Tracy's coming in May.
So let's see, Heather says, I made the Pampered Chef braided bread, yeah, so it's a similar thing with chicken, where'd it go? Chicken and broccoli for my husband for his lunch. Wait, you made that today? Wow, that's a coincidence,
yeah. That maybe good. She knew this was coming and you inspired her.
I know, but now I'm thinking that would be a great meal.
I forget about recipes. You know, like that was something I used to make a lot. I forget, like I'll make something so much that we kind of get sick of it. And then I kind of forget. And then I go, you know, remember 2 years ago when I used to make the blah, blah, blah. Because there was another Pampered Chef recipe where you used biscuits, just canned biscuits to form like a pizza dough. Mm-hmm. And you spread it with pesto sauce. And then it had like sliced zucchini and tomatoes on it. And it was so good. And I still remember I used to make that. I would send it with my husband at his lunch to work. And one day he had set his lunch on top of the car and driven off.
Oh, no.
And it was like the last piece of it. And it got like smashed. And I was like, oh, that stuff was so good. I can eat that myself. He was just going to forget about it.
That's so nice that you
have to make that again.
Make lunches for your husband.
Oh. Yeah.
Well, that's not true. We pack his, if there's leftovers, we have like little containers. And so he takes leftovers. Okay.
It's my, one of the few things.
Cheryl says, I like Pamela's gluten-free flour and mixes. I do too. The regular Pamela's gluten-free flour, they're chocolate chip cookies. It's great. They're just like regular Toll House cookies. It's great. I think now's a great time to be gluten-free. When we first started, there was nothing. You had to mix your own flowers. There were two cookbooks. I bought them both. They weren't that great.
Yeah.
Now is a great time.
Well, they're getting so better about accommodating any kind of dietary preference, you know, with vegan stuff too, and more plant-based stuff. Mm-hmm. And yeah, gluten-free. Because, yeah, restaurants now, a lot of times they'll have gluten-free. You know, they'll tell you on the menu.
Yes.
So I know, yeah,
so
yeah,
nice.
I'm more aware of that now that, you know, we're friends and stuff, because mm-hmm. I, you know, we'll look for that and things.
Carol says, Melissa, your recipe in the book calls for all-purpose flour. What did you use? So I used a different recipe for this, Carol. The recipe in the book is not a gluten-free recipe. This recipe, I used Caputo gluten-free flour, which is what it's an Italian gluten-free flour, and it's what I use for pizza and breads because it's just the best, and it has a really good, like, kind of almost a wheat flavor. And then she uses psyllium husk, which I just learned is actually, according to my son, a laxative. But I think it's actually just fiber. But it adds a...
Yeah, then that with what's in Metamucil.
Yeah. So, but it adds something to the flour. So
that's like nutritional yeast, too. That's kind of used sometimes as a substitute for, like, Parmesan cheese or something. Yeah.
Yeah, that's in our curry recipe. But I'll post this recipe. I'll just put it on my website, too, or the link to it, to her website. Heather made lentil soup. Braided bread was a while ago. Oh, I gotcha. Okay. I didn't know. So Carol's gluten-free too. She says she's a gluten-free housewife.
Oh.
Wow. Okay. Well, we need to chat. So many recipes. Gluten-free on a shoestring. That was our go-to. But now this lady, the gluten-free cake, let them eat gluten-free cake. She's my go-to now.
Yeah. I tend to remember what liquor people like. The important things. So no, Carol doesn't like sweet wine. You don't like sweet wine.
I do not like sweet wine. Do you have any more questions?
I like any kind of wine. That was pretty much it, but I thought it was a great book. I loved how that you tied in the Christmas theme with the costumes also. I thought that was very, very clever. Because yeah, it's like, okay, how you're trying to identify a person and they don't look like themselves. That was a really good good trick. Sorry. It's another way to make it harder.
Yeah.
Because then even if you witness something, you're like, well, I witnessed something, but there's five people that look just like this character.
Well, that required them to look at Pippin's photographs. Ivy's photographs too, because she was photographer of the party. Yeah. So that gave a reason to go back and really study them to see if they could discern anything, because they were all costumed and there were so many chimney sweeps and carolers and whatnot.
That was actually another thing I thought of as I was reading this. And I like that she's kind of multidimensional, and like she works at the bread shop, but that's kind of a part-time thing for her. And that fulfills kind of like a creative and that's like a family to her.
Yeah.
You know, Olya is kind of like a substitute mom and her connection with all those people. And then it's also a way to help the community.
Yeah.
But then she's got her photography thing, which is her own thing and her own creative stuff.
And that's what she left behind in Austin. She had her business, but then she got divorced and so left it all behind to come home. So yeah, I was trying, you know, she's slowly been building that part of herself up again.
So did you know Miguel was going to propose when you started writing the book?
I knew that I wanted him to propose. I didn't know exactly how it was going to happen, but I'm happy with how it
went. I like that it was a family ring too. Mm-hmm. My ring was my husband's grandmother's ring. My
ring is my grandmother's ring.
Oh, see?
I have to tell you this story. So how are we on time?
Go. It is 8:52.
Okay. Yes. So my grandmother died the year that I was married, and we were married December 30th. So we just had our anniversary. And my grandfather died that year too. After my grandmother passed, they gave me her wedding ring, but my grandfather pulled Carlos aside and gave him his wedding ring, which is just very lightly engraved. And, you know, we got it cleaned and everything. And so it was really sentimental and lovely that we both had their wedding rings. Well, so this one time, probably 20 years ago, Carlos was camping and swimming in this reservoir, Sugar Pine Reservoir in Northern California, and he came out without the ring.
Where's the
ring? Oh my gosh. And coincidentally, one of his students was also camping there with his family. And so they spent hours looking for that ring. And, you know, finally Carlos had to go, and the kid was like, I'll find it for you. And, you know, he didn't have any expectation. But then at school on Monday, the kid was like, I found it.
Oh my gosh.
So he actually spent the entire day diving into this little, you know, it's just a shallow area of the reservoir, but I mean, he found that ring.
That is sweet.
Yeah.
And that says a lot about Carlos and his effect on students. I mean, yeah, I would have never done that for any of my principals.
I know, right?
Yeah. Maybe Mr. Lord. He was nice.
So I didn't even know who any of my principals were. Yeah. I don't remember.
Oh, we had one, Barbara Kruger in Austin. And she like wanted to be one of the popular kids. It was weird.
She wanted to.
Yeah, she's like always like if she saw the, you know, cheerleaders and football boys walking down, she'd always kind of, you know, it's just like
that's wild.
It was strange.
Yeah.
And I remember she couldn't say the word Toyota because if anybody left their lights on in their car, you know, she'd announce it and she'd say, "There's a Toyota, not Toyota, a Toyota."
Oh.
And then it kind of became this running joke that anyone with a Toyota would leave their lights on. So she'd go, "There's a Toyota in the parking lot with its lights on, a Toyota."
She from West Texas? That's so funny.
She did have big hair. Of course, that was the 80s. I had big hair in the 80s too. So
I have thin, fine hair, so I could try for days and I would never have
my hair's big today. Because we did an impromptu overnighter at Myrtle Beach with some of my husband's friends. And we were out on the beach today and it started raining, so I just went with it. I just leaned in.
Just embraced it. Yeah. Embraced the humidity.
I was like, oh, okay, whatever.
It has been humid the past few days.
Oh, so. I know. Yeah, we don't know whether to turn the air conditioner back on. And then it's like, okay, air conditioning in December and January.
But now it's cold front's coming tonight. They canceled school, so it's supposed to snow tomorrow.
Yeah, Carol, I think I heard Nashville is supposed to have snow. So you'll have to let me know tomorrow. I'm assuming the interstates will be clear. All that. So.
Okay. Yeah, well, you need to maybe leave early.
Yeah.
I don't know. Okay, so a few more comments. So Carol says we're a gluten-free household too. Her son had to be gluten-free, has to be, and the rest of us go along with it.
Okay, now I remember you talking about that. Yeah.
Well, if you ever want recipe ideas, I have many, many, many. Cheryl says, I love costumes. I really like that element in the story. I love Dickens. My dad took us 1 year to see Patrick Stewart perform a Christmas Carol because apparently it was meant to be performed by one person when it was written. I don't know if that's true or not, but that's what my dad told us at the time.
You mean like telling it, reciting it?
Yeah, but then acting out the parts, you know, you can go into voices and stuff. And he was amazing. And I don't know, I've always loved A Christmas Carol, but especially ever since that particular time. So that was fun.
She wants your last bite.
I know. I'm saving it. Yeah. So everybody's saying, yeah, that was awesome about the ring. It really was. Carol says, I just started your book and I'm really looking forward to reading the rest after hearing you talk about it. I had to finish the new Gabaldon book first. Well, that's by like 2,000 pages.
She's kind of like the Game of Thrones guy.
Oh my gosh. That's fine. So that's an interesting question. Do you read more than one book at a time? Because Heather says she has to read one at a time too. Carol says there's no snow yet. Tomorrow's supposed to be good.
I do sometimes because I'll have like one on the bedside and then one somewhere else in the house. And they're almost more a matter of the place where I am.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes I'll have one in my computer bag. So like if I'm out somewhere having to wait or you know, a lot of times I have stuff on my phone and I have like multiple books, you know, going on my phone, on my Kindle app or my Nook app. So kind of depending on what I'm in the mood for.
Yeah,
I'll read different ones.
Yeah, I'm the same. If I'm reading a print book, like an actual print book, I can't read it at night. I don't know, my just eyes are tired by that point, so I have to read that during the day. And I always read at night in bed, so I always have a book going on my Nook. And then I walk the dogs daily, and I listen in the car, and while I'm walking to an Audible book.
Yeah, I do that too. Yeah.
So I love that, and then.
I was wondering what the neighbors think when they, like, I'm walking by and it's like, and then they were stabbed and the knife was covered in blood.
Oh, you don't do it with headphones? Oh, that's funny.
No, because I want to be able to hear if cars are coming up and stuff. So,
Okay, that's funny. So multiple books going. But I will say that there are times if it doesn't grab me, I can't even remember what I was reading. If I'm, you know, like now I just started one a couple of nights ago. And for the first two nights, I'm like, what am I reading? I don't even remember until I get in bed. I'm like, oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
But now I'm really into it, and I'm like, I can't wait to get back to it.
Just kind of a slow starter.
Yeah. Quirky. But so Joanne says, I can only read one at a time. Heather says, I read print books, always in bed to go to sleep. Tried the iPad, but it really hurt when it hit me in the face when I fell asleep.
Oh, no.
Yeah, that would be. Carlos had that happen. He said, I know I'm really getting old because I fell asleep with the book.
Oh,
oh gosh. Yeah, Tracy, Audible's great. Audiobooks, I mean, whatever platform.
Yeah, I like because you can be moving around doing stuff. Mm-hmm. And,
yeah, and if that's a really good book at a really good point, then I'll keep walking or I'll come in and do chores or whatever so I can mm-hmm. keep listening. Mm-hmm. You know, it makes me do good stuff. All right. Shall we call it tonight?
Okay.
Thank you guys for spending Sunday evening with us. And if you haven't read A Murder Yule Regret, I hope that you do. You don't have to wait till next Christmas. Yeah. And I will be giving away 3 signed copies tomorrow from random people, 4 random people in the comments. So just leave a comment if you haven't already, and I'll just do a random drawing.
And that's the star bread right there on the
that's
cover.
That's right, yeah. And then there's
if you can see it,
Agatha, who's modeled after Bean, who's my pug, who's snoring on the couch.
He's right over
there. So another Susan says, I usually have 1 on Kindle, oops, and a hard copy, oops, and an audiobook for the car going. Yep. So Susan,
it is. Yeah, that's kind of a. I guess kind of how. What I was thinking too, because it's like you need different methods for mm-hmm.
different
places,
situations. Yeah. All right, you guys, this was so fun. Okay, Joanne, I will not enter you, but thank you for being here with us. Thank you guys for being here with us, and I highly recommend that you try this recipe, right?
Yeah, it's really good. I very highly recommend it.
Yeah, and even if you don't do gluten-free, this is a good one. I don't know. I can't attest to the non-gluten-free one. They told me it was good, but
push really hard.
Yeah. All right, good night, guys. Oh, do we want to announce the next book?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So the January book is going to be One of Us by Lori Lewis Ham. She is a writer and also a big supporter of the community. She does great things for the mystery writers. She is on Mystery Rat, which is a podcast. So if you're not aware of that, she's with Kings River Life, which is an online magazine. And she's given a lot of other writers a lot of promos. So we really appreciate that. But it's a great book too. I'm about a third of the way into that. So,
oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. We'll be posting about that on the Facebook page soon.
Yeah. So. Yeah. We'll share what it is in the details. So we'll have another chat with her at the end of the month.
Yep.
Yes. So this was fun.
See y'all soon.
Happy reading.
Pippin's little baby.